The Arabic phrase that Lindsay was searching for is La Shukra al-Wajib. It means, don't thank me for doing my duty. And I want to start with this point. You see, we're not just defending the Muslims because it's the right thing to do. We have an interest in this. A long time ago, a Christian clergyman, Pastor Naimullah, said this. They came for the communists, and I was not a communist, so I did not protest. They came for the trade unionists, I was not a trade unionist, so I did not protest. Then they came for the Jews, I was not a Jew, and I did not protest. Then they came for me, and there was nobody left to protest. That's another reason why we are standing beside the Muslims under attack today. This is a very important concept to grasp. You see, there was a song about the Spanish Civil War, the refrain of which, a modern song, was if you tolerate this, then your children will be next. And that's true. If you let them come for the halal meat, then they'll next come for the hijab. If you let them come for the Muslims, they will next come for somebody else, maybe us. This is a crucial question because we have a job to do despite the vibrancy and size of this rally. Today, there is a problem which I intend, if I can, to deal with in this speech. Amongst a very large segment of public opinion in this country which regards themselves as liberal, even progressive, those people that by implication John Rees was referring to when he said that anti-Muslim racism was the last respectable form of racism in our society. I see it when I write a blog on the Guardian website. Hundreds of people who define themselves as liberal pour into the blog a torrent of Islamophobic abuse, bigotry, and prejudice in a way that they would never dream of doing about black people or Jewish people or any other racial or religious group in this country. This is a problem that we must address. You know, as somebody said on one of my blogs the other day, a Muslim blogger said, you know this, I prefer the BNP fascist approach, who tell us openly that they hate us, to the liberals who want to tell us how to live and how to dress because they think they know what is good for us, how to liberate us, how to free us. Now, I've just been outside in the radio car talking to the PM program, to be going out in 20 minutes or so. It was a case study in the false dichotomy which has been created around this subject of the veil. The woman said to me, from the BBC headquarters to a radio car in Houston, but Jack Straw has a point, doesn't he? 50% of communication is visual. It's difficult, she said, communicating with people if you can't see their face. a radio presenter. In which case I said, what's the point of this interview? I can't see you, you can't see me, and the listeners can't see either of us. It's a preposterous command. If it was true, David Blunkett wouldn't have been much of an MP these last 27 years. He's never seen anybody's face. If it was true, you couldn't do any work on the telephone, or on the email, or by fax. It can't possibly be true that Jack, after all this time, representing so many Muslims, being returned to Parliament by them in overwhelming numbers so many times, suddenly discovered the semiotics of visual communication. It cannot possibly be true. So it must be something else. And that something else is why we are so angry about this. Because everybody with a brain knows the reason why Jack Straw got down and dirty and scraped the bottom of this filthy barrel was to join the Dutch auction in New Labour of who can be most beastly to a minority which is already beleaguered and anxious in this country. And it's a disgusting, ugly sight and sound to see or listen to. You see, he noticed how successful John Reed's expedition to the Far East of London had been. At least with Jack, with John Reed, it was man to man, hand to hand fighting, with a man that looked like he could fight Mike Tyson. Jack dragged out a small minority of Muslim women, women with problems. They need to have problems to go to Jack Straw for a solution, I can tell you. In order to beat them up, to please the Sun and the Express and the Mail, to put them up the charts of recognition, so that when he threw his hat into the ring for the Labour deputy leadership, he would have a better chance of winning. Before I leave John Reed, let me develop the point that Salma made. I did it in an open letter to John Reed, which he hasn't yet replied to. That man that I'm talking about, Abu Izzaddin, I know him well. He locked me in a room and threatened to hang me during the general election in 2005, so I know him very well. He's been on Newsnight praising the 7/7 bombers. He's been in newspaper after newspaper, picture and words, with his separatism, with his extremism, with his talk of violence. How did he get within punching distance of the British Home Secretary in East London? Either our security services are so utterly incompetent, Bin Laden himself could have been in the Leyton Community Center. Or John Reed wanted this man there to set up exactly the kind of altercation that would make his point.